Before the Honourable Bill English.
Madam Speaker, my question is to the Minister of Justice and asks, is it government policy that the electoral law should allow public money from Vote Parliamentary Service to be used to produce and publish election advertisements? If so, why?
Madam Speaker.
The Honourable Annette King.
Madam Speaker, the expenditure of public money from Vote Parliamentary Services is the responsibility of the Minister in charge of that vote. The Electoral Finance Act sets out the rules relating to election advertising.
A supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
Has the Minister seen a widely distributed email from the General Manager of Parliamentary Service which says that under the Electoral Finance Act passed by the Government, parties can legitimately use money from Vote Parliamentary Service to pay for election advertisements in an election year? And why did Labor change the law to allow this to happen?
Madam Speaker,
the Honourable
Madam Speaker, I have seen the email from Geoff Thorne, and I have also spoken to him about his email, giving good advice, a very sensible email to all members, giving advice of the overlap between publicity and election advertising. He informs me he has no examples to give me of how this would work, but he's trying to warn people to be very careful when they're using parliamentary funding and make sure that it does not run up against the Electoral Finance Act. And he goes on to tell members where they can get that advice from.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
Was the intention of changing the law so that Labor could put out a publication like this? A glossy booklet, fully paid for by the taxpayer, with the parliamentary crest on it, paid for by Parliamentary Services, which is undoubtedly an election advertisement, because under Section 5 of the Electoral Finance Act, it can reasonably be regarded as encouraging or persuading voters to vote for Labor, and it's paid for by Parliamentary Services.
The
Madam
Annette
Speaker,
King.
I suggest to the member that the Electoral Commission will make that decision, but I can also say to the member that this booklet was put out in 2007 before the Electoral Finance Act was passed, just as this pamphlet was put out before the Electoral Finance Act was passed, which could be said to be electioneering. I suggest to the National Party and the Labor Party that they get advice from the Electoral Commission.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
Can she confirm that this booklet actually...
Order!
Point of order, Madam Speaker.
The Honourable Bill English.
Madam Speaker, the odd interjection during a question I'm sure is acceptable to the House, but continuous barracking does make it difficult to be heard.
Thank you. I had already dealt with it, Mr English, but it wasn't continuous barracking. It was a sole intervention, and it will not be heard again while you're asking your question.
The Honourable Bill English.
During the previous question, there were half a dozen interventions.
If, in fact, members want no interventions during questions or answers, I would be delighted. Otherwise, I will manage that process. The Honourable Bill English.
Supplementary, Madam Speaker. Can she confirm that this booklet distributed this year, even if it was produced last year, and then therefore covered by the law, is just like Labor's pledge card put out before 2005 election? It is an election advertisement produced during...
Order.
That it is an election advertisement produced during an election period and paid for out of taxpayer funding. And the only difference is that this is now legal because Labor passed the Electoral Finance Act.
That's right. Madam Speaker.
The Honourable
Annette
King.
This booklet put out by Labor was distributed last year. It was approved in October last year, paid for in November last year and distributed last year. Just as this one was put out last year and has a date of the 1st of December on it last year. So I say to the member that both of these perhaps should get advice as to whether they would in this year contravene the Electoral Finance Act, and that is in the hands of the Electoral Commissioner.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
Can the Minister confirm that because this booklet was distributed this year and is probably an election advertisement, It therefore requires the authorisation of Mike Smith, the General Secretary of the Labor Party and the financial agent for them, and will she ensure that her own party follows the authorisation rules the way it expects everyone else in the country to do it?
Madam Speaker, can I assure the member I expect the Labor Party and the National Party and any other party to follow the law of this country. And this, in fact, would also have to have an authorisation on it if it was to follow it. You see, what we get from the National Party
order.
Is double standards. They bring in one that was released last year and raise it. They don't bring in another that was released last year and highlight that. My advice is that they go to the Electoral Commission to get the advice on whether they are counted, because everyone ought to be very, very careful.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
Well, given the Minister's enthusiasm that everyone should keep the law, can she explain why, under the Electoral Finance Act, the financial agent of a candidate or a party must include their full home address on any authorisation? And does she agree with Labor Party President Mike Williams, who said a few weeks ago that people expressing concerns about this provision of the law were a bit paranoid?
Speaker?
No, the Honourable
Madam Speaker, I think the issue of putting proper addresses on came out of the Exclusive Brethren pamphlets, where addresses were put on and nobody lived there. Fake addresses were put on, and the National Party supported that. They were their mates. It was their money supporting them. And they think there's something wrong with being upfront and honest about saying who you are and where you live.
Supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
So can we take it the Minister has confirmed that the law requires that any authorisation must include the residential address of the financial agent, the law passed by her? And has she seen this CD of Labor's campaign song distributed last night, authorised by Mike Smith, General Secretary of the Labor Party, which does not state his home address, but states the Labor Party headquarters address,
and is that where he lives?
And why shouldn't that party comply with the draconian law that expect everyone else to comply with?
Order. The Honourable Annette
King. Madam Speaker, no, I have not seen that. But I would ask this. Did the DVD that John Key put out, which is now still in circulation, does it have a name on it? Does it have a address on it? And it could certainly count against the Electoral Finance Act. I want to know what's written on that. Produce one in this House so we can see it.
Order. Right, Honourable Winston Peters, supplementary question.
Seeing as the Minister is dealing clearly with historic costs, could she tell us, with respect to the foreshore and seabed issue, who paid for the numerous hoardings outlining that it would be Kiwi, not Iwi, but apparently in 2008 it's anybody, anywhere, anytime? And could she confirm also that the National Party's recent update of their current song is really an old replay of Dean Martin's Born to Lose? Who's paying for that?
The Minister must answer the question for where the ministerial responsibility lies.
Well, Madam Speaker, I am searching for that, but... I have to say it was an excellent question, and we all know that the Parliamentary Services paid for those billboards. The National Party used the taxpayers' money, then mounted a campaign against other parties, as we know, last year and the year before, trying to pretend that their hands were clean. They never were.
Order. The supplementary question, the Honourable Bill English.
When will the Labor Party start taking responsibility for its own compliance with its own law and take this document to the Electoral Commission, because it was distributed last week at the Waikato University Open Day and is almost certainly an election advertisement, and this CD, which clearly does not comply with the law that the government passed? When will Labor take responsibility recall these materials and get a legal opinion on whether they can keep distributing them.
The Honourable Annette.
Madam Speaker, I have no doubt that the Labor Party will be taking their responsibilities very seriously. But what we haven't heard...
Bennett will please leave the chamber, as will Chris Archambault. I am tired of the constant barracking I saw and heard you two at this time. Members simply must keep it down.
Madam Speaker, I'll
start again. The Honourable Annette King.
Madam Speaker, I am sure the Labor Party will take their responsibilities very seriously, but I have to question whether the person asking the question today also takes the National Party's seriously. And if they do, they will send this to the Electoral Commission and get a ruling on it. It's last year the member said, and it's still available today. It is still available today. And I want to know whether they will also send the DVD from John Key to the Electoral Commission. Came out last year. Some people still have it. Can still be played this year. And when... and was given out, and listen to this, Madam Speaker, was given out in Auckland Central in January. In January, will they send that DVD to the Electoral Commission? Then maybe we'll take these questions a bit more seriously.
Right. Order. The Right Honourable Winston Peters. The right order,
point of
right
order.
Honourable Winston Peters.
Point of order.
No, we've got a point of order on the floor first, and then I will take Dr Smith.
Well, my point of order is, Madam Speaker, when you said that I could ask my question, Mr English interjected four more times. Mm. No regard for anybody else. Not been here very long, not being very good performer in the time he has been here, but I think he should actually... have some respect for other political parties and give them the right to ask questions in the same way just a few minutes ago he was demanding the right himself.
Yes, I agree that all members, including those on the front bench, should please get themselves under control and give respect to others so they can be heard. We have another point of order, however, the Honourable Dr Nick Smith.
Madam Speaker, the Minister of Justice has three times accused me of breaking the law. Can I give this House an absolute assurance that newsletter was distributed entirely, as I have done every year I've been a Member of Parliament, to every household in Nelson last November, and not one has been distributed.
I thank the member, but it's not a point of order. No, I've dealt with the point. It isn't a point of order, so would the member please be seated or the minister will be leaving this chamber. Now, we have a supplementary question.
Thank you, Madam Speaker.
Right Honourable Winston.
Madam Speaker, could the Minister advise the House as to whether she's received any reports on the requirement for a street address for those people who are authorising advertisements, and how will it affect, for example, Exclusive Brethren Church, who have taken their directions directly out of the United States and will not have a domicile in New Zealand, which I understand would comply with the law?
Madam Speaker, no, I have not received any advice on that. But it is a very interesting idea, and obviously I think the Exclusive Brethren...
The Honourable Annette King.
Well done, Jerry. It's the best speech you've made all week. And he didn't even have to leave the safety of his seat to do it. Madam Speaker, in response to that question, no, I haven't received any advice on that, but I would say to the Exclusive Brethren, if they are planning the sort of campaign they had last year, they too ought to get advice from the Electoral Commission.
Any further supplementary question, the Honourable Dr.
Can I ask the Minister, can she assure the House it will not be an election advertisement to carry a newspaper story which purports to be a clarification, which was not given with the consent or indeed, I believe, the knowledge of the journalist who ran the original story, or the editor at the time, or the local management of that newspaper, but at the behest of the chief executive of the organisation on demand from the National Party? And can she further clarify that the organisation who owned the newspaper, ABN, won't be required to register as a third party?
No, it's hard to see where the ministerial responsibility lies for that. No, I'm sorry.
Can we move on now to a point of order, the Honourable Trevor Mallard?
Madam Speaker, I am reluctant to argue with you, but this is a very important point. The Minister has been repeatedly asked for her interpretation of the Act by the National Party. You have allowed all of those questions. Dr Cullen has again asked for her interpretation of the Act as to whether something is in or out. He's asked for an assurance in that area, and it's my view that that question is within the rules, just as all the others you've allowed have been.
Well, speaking to the point of order, Gerry Brownlee.
Speaker, I think you've ruled appropriately, because quite obviously Dr Cullen and others would know that the Minister's answer is simply going to be go and ask the Electoral Commission or go to the courts, because she's given the House absolutely no elucidation as to her own views on this on these matters at all.
The Honourable Annette Kim.
Madam Speaker, I would be grateful for your ruling in this respect, because what happens in these questions is that I am asked for my personal opinion. It doesn't count when it comes to election advertising. It is the Electoral Commissioner's view who counts. And so I suggest that maybe you might like to rule out all questions asking for my opinion about what's
Thank
in
you.
And what's
I,
out.
I understand. No, this is a good point of order, and it does raise an issue. And it is when opinions are sought that in effect are asking for a legal interpretation. Now, all members know that is not actually permitted under our standing orders. I give notice, therefore, that I suggest you do think carefully about the way in which questions are phrased, because the matter has been raised. If legal opinions are called for, they will not be permitted. Point of order, Gerry Brownlee.
My point of order is this, Madam Chair. If you're going to say that you can't ask questions that may require a legal opinion, how do you then question the intention of a minister who brings a bill to the House that subsequently seems to be quite troublesome? When we know that, we're told frequently by the Clerk's Office that the commentary of bills is the place where courts may go to find out the very intention of Parliament. Now, surely it should be the intention and understanding of the Minister that would be also of relevance to the courts in interpreting this stuff. So are you saying that rather than saying we want the Minister to interpret, we should simply say what was the intention? Because it seems to us that it was pretty clear that the intention was, in the case that Mr English raised, for someone to put a residential address on a piece of election collateral. But the Labor Party have now said that they don't have to, effectively. And we can only assume that this is what the Minister meant when she said that common sense would prevail throughout this.
Oh, the Honourable Dr Michael Cullen.
Mr Speaker, the standing orders are actually quite clear,
yes,
under 3712, that questions must not seek a legal opinion. That doesn't mean so people can ask ministers what the intent of a piece of legislation was. But actually to ask, as I did indeed Mr English on a number of occasions, is a particular thing illegal, then that of course is actually improper. No. And you quite rightly ruled my question out, but I'm still grateful to get it in.
I thought you might be. Now, it's not the point, however, and members do that on all sides of the House slightly too often. May I say, then, I do refer the members, those who are interested in the standing orders, 3712 makes it quite clear. As I also made it clear in my ruling, it may not be on the wit of some of you to be able to frame your questions and give your answers in terms of the standing orders. It is not for the Speaker to advise you on how to do either, however much you'd like to on occasions. Now, point of order, the Honourable Bill English.
Well, Madam Speaker, just one other matter we should clarify. You said in your original statement that asking an opinion of the Electoral Commission may affect your ruling. It's important, I think, for the whole House to understand that the Electoral Commission can only give an opinion. It can't give a ruling. That, in fact, if the law says you have to have a residential address, even if the Electoral Commission said that's not right, the courts are the final arbiter of this law, and no one is protected by an Electoral Commission opinion any more than they are protected by the Minister's opinion.